has begun.
Get your motor running. Head out on the highway. And whatever comes our way. Take the world in a loving embrace. Explode into space. Heavy metal thunder.
Hello, welcome to another episode of Cafe De Rene. I'm your host, James Spencer, joined once again by the star of the show, Mr. Rene Dupree. Rene, bonjour.
Happy Halloween. Actually, no, we're taping this on Halloween, but today's the 1st of November. Man, it's going quick.
Christmas soon.
Soon.
So, welcome around the supermarket today. Just get some sweets for the kids for when they come round. Mm. As they was taking the sweets down, they was putting up the Christmas stuff up. I was like, oh, Jesus. I used to love Christmas when I was a child, but you know, when you got three sons,
it's
a bit stressful.
It's not so much fun anymore, especially on the wallet.
Well, I don't think they watched this show, but they wanted a PlayStation 5 for Christmas, and I got my hands on one, so it's packed away. So hopefully they don't listen to this show.
Right.
Yeah. So you had a pretty exciting night last night. Tell everyone about it.
Yeah. Well, I reunited with my tag partner, Dr. Wagner. We were in Niagara Falls last night for Resolution 10, and we had a great match, and it will be airing on WrestleUniverse.com on November 9th, I believe. So if you're not signed up, sign up, and catch me and Wagner back in action. It was great to see him again. We tore it up.
Who was he squared up against?
It was CK Savage and Chris Thorne, two locals from the Niagara Falls region, St. Catherine region.
Yeah.
It was great to see him again, and we haven't missed a beat, man. We're tearing it up like always.
This must be the first time you've used a tag now for quite a while.
It's been about a year and a half.
Wow.
Yeah,
I know you've done some single stuff, the odd bit during this time, obviously on Hannibal's show and like the other shows, but tagging again, like after a year and a half different, like was it, like you said, didn't miss a beat, or was there still little bits of adjustment you had to get used to?
He's down in Mexico, and they, you know, they're running steady. Up here in Canada, it's like hit or miss, right? But we had great chemistry, and I can't wait to tear shit up again, man. There's talks about going down to Mexico soon.
Oh, great.
Doing some stuff down there. So I'm excited.
Yeah. Mexico is one of them places I love to always go to. Can imagine how exciting it is. I think you've done a show or two down there before, haven't you?
Back in 2008, I did Dragon Mania, which is Ultimo Dragon's big show of the year. He runs Arena Mexico. And that was a real cool experience. You know, those Mexican crowds are awesome, man.
Funny you mentioned Ultimo Dragon, so I've just come across something. So he recently done an interview, and he was accompanied by Sonny Uno to be his translator during this interview.
Yeah.
And because he was brought into WWE in 2003, had a bit of a short run, didn't last as long as what we would love to, because obviously we was all fans of his work in WCW, but apparently in this interview, he actually said that when he joined WWE, because Rey Mysterio was already there, WWE creative actually wanted him to take the mask off and wrestle without it.
Oh, that makes sense.
That's the first I've heard of it.
Yeah, it makes sense, you know. It's like you can have a giant, but then as soon as you bring in another 7-footer, then it makes you less special, right?
Yeah.
Yeah. So, you know, I guess maybe from a business standpoint, the Hispanic audience for WWE is more valuable. Maybe even though that Ultimo was a huge star in Mexico and can speak fluent Spanish, you know.
Yeah.
But it is what it is, man. But it makes sense that the, you know, the, you have one masked wrestler, you're going to concentrate on promoting him and not have anything that might jeopardize that, right?
Yeah, and it's crazy to think of, because in WCW, every luchador got unmasked. I think Ultimo, ironically, was the only one who didn't, but
right.
Everyone else did.
Right.
And it's weird, because you mentioned the merchandise, and it's like, well, like WCW, obviously WCW's eggs was purely in that NWO basket, and to a degree, Goldberg possibly and DDP, but it was mainly NWO. And when you realize how much merchandise WB sold, like Rey Mysterio masks, it makes you realize, like, WCW, wow, you had, like, Hoovy to Mysterio, obviously Ultimo Dragon, Psychosis. There were so many masked wrestlers who had to pull the merchandise off, and they just didn't.
Right. Yeah. There's a lot of missed opportunities in that promotion, right?
Oh, yeah, that's one of the reasons, unfortunately, they're not in business anymore. And following on that, unfortunately, it looks like Ring of Honor isn't going to be in business anymore.
Well, oversaturation, my friend. There's too much. You can watch wrestling on television. I don't know how it is in the UK, but here in Canada.
Yeah.
Day, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, Saturday, and Sunday. And then you got the internet where you can watch anything, anytime, any, you know. It's too much. I like steak. I like filet mignon. But if I have it every night of the week, eventually I'm going to get sick of it, you know.
So. Yeah. It's similar over here. If you got the right packages and whatever, WWE's on three times a week, for example. You got AEW on twice a week. You got Impact Wrestling. And that doesn't take into account the likes of, obviously, Ring of Honor for the time it was on, and MLW and such. So it's weird. Like, as a wrestling fan, I shouldn't complain too much wrestling. But like you said, you can have too much of something. And fortunately, you know, you lose interest. But too much of something is bad. And with Ring of Honor, unfortunately, COVID hit them really bad. And I mean, the nice thing they was doing, they were still paying the talent, which was great.
Yeah.
But
yeah,
obviously, doing that and keep trying to keep everyone on the books. But no, not many live shows. Like, they were still recording some shows, empty arenas. And even though they've done a good job of it, because Ring of Honor's work rate and style, it's purely in ring, and it kind of worked what they was doing, but you need them fans coming in, you need money coming in, and if it's not coming in, the well dries up eventually.
That's it. You hit the nail on the head there, bud.
Well, like, obviously, you've grown up in the Canadian territories, and I mean, Canada, I don't know. Who would you say is the biggest territory in Canada? Is it Hannibal or someone else now?
Well, Toronto, Ontario is probably the biggest market as far as running shows and stuff. But, you know, like, they might run once a month or once every 2 months or, you know, four or five times a year. But then there's several different promotions, right? But the same thing. It's like, if you got one promotion or one town, but three or four different promotions run it.
Yeah.
It's oversaturation. It's too much, right?
And, so a few of the details come out of Ring of Honor. So basically the whole roster has been released pretty much. Some of them still under contract, so they'll still get paid. I think some of them still under contract till January, for example. They're hoping to be running shows again in April, which is 5 months away. I'm thinking, I don't know. I don't think that's going to happen. I'm hoping I'm wrong, because I don't want to see anyone out of a job, and I don't want to see a wrestling company go under, because growing up, I've seen so many. For example, just said to you off camera, I'm watching ECW now, which it was great for time, and to see that going under. And obviously, we just mentioned previously WCW, but the AEW fans come out on full force and saying to Tony Khan, sign this person, sign that person.
Uh-huh. About this one, this one.
About midnight.
This one.
And I'm like, right. He's got way too many wrestlers. He's not using at the minute. I'm like, And like you said, oversaturation. It's going to be interesting to see where a lot of these people go. There's some great talents, like sort of Mike Bennett, Jonathan Gresham, Vincent, Matt Taven, and many others, Joe Hendry from the UK. So hopefully they all land on their feet, but like, must be, I mean, it came out of the blue. I was recording another show, and the lad said to me, they went, well, Ring of Honor's released everyone. I'm like, what? And I was completely shocked. So what's it been like? What could it be like for them wrestlers just to wake up and like, the company's gone out of business. What are we going to do now?
Right. I know. It's scary times. There's so many great wrestlers out there, and there's too many promotions. Okay. Especially right now, man. Like, one thing I do follow is like the economy and all these strategists, and they're predicting like 2022 is going to be the worst economy. Like, we're hitting into like one of the worst depressions in world history.
Yeah.
And if people don't got money for gas or for food, you think they're going to spend money on a wrestling show? Right?
Yeah. And I mean, do we say what people can say about them? They're making record profits every year. It's crazy. And when we see AEW, and AEW's putting on a good show, and I'm enjoying it, but Tony Khan, he's signing all these people contracts, he's spending a lot of money, and I'm thinking, how much money is actually coming in? So, yeah. If hopefully it doesn't happen, but if we do go into another coronavirus and lockdown and things like that, can AEW last another year of this happening, or the likes of MLW or Impact Wrestling, who's struggling? So,
I heard MLW is releasing some guys too, right?
I think so. I think they're like, I don't know if they do live streams or what network, but I think they're only getting like 40,000 fans, viewers.
What's the deal with these contracts? Are they getting a weekly guarantee, or is it like they're just contracted like guaranteed shows, or what?
MLW, I don't know. Impact Wrestling does have full-time contracts, but they still let wrestlers do other shows, so independent shows.
Okay.
But they also have some wrestlers that's not, who's wrestling for them, but not exclusive contracts.
Like pay-per-appearance?
Kind of. Or it's weird. It's kind of a pay-for-appearance, because I talk to a lot of people in Impact Wrestling, so I've got an idea what's happening there. So I've got a few go-betweens who I speak to, and when they say to me, like, oh, such and such is on a full-time contract, and this person isn't, and it's hard from a booking standpoint, because it's like, would you really want to stick your belt on someone who's not signed proper to the company, who can just leave at any time? So that's, but obviously, that's the financials of wrestling these days. Besides WWE, every other company, AEW's got the money, I suppose, as well. But every other company, it's another kind of handcuffed with finances. And MLW, they've been struggling. Apparently, they're only getting like 30 or 40,000 viewers every show. Impact Wrestling, it's hit and miss. It can be around about 200,000, which isn't great compared to especially like 10 years ago where it was. But it's not a great time for the financials of wrestling. It really isn't.
Well, that's the nature of the wrestling business, man. It's like a roller coaster. It goes through peaks and valleys, right?
Yeah.
And but it's so exposed, and it's so oversaturated that, what's that Jim Cornette line? How do you put the toothpaste back in the tube?
So fingers crossed, Ring of Honor does return it. Like I said, it's got one more show, Final Battle, and I think they've already taped some shows, the final tapings. But we'll find out next April. But by then, a lot of the roster hopefully do get jobs somewhere else. But if Ring of Honor does come back, then hopefully they go back there. So we'll move on to WWE. And we never spoke about it last week, obviously, because we were speaking till Sylvan, which, great episode. Everyone's really enjoyed it. And if you're a new viewer, and if you haven't checked out, please check it out. It's a great episode. But so one of the things WWE likes to do is book themselves in a corner. So obviously, a couple of weeks ago, it was the draft. And Becky Lynch was the current SmackDown Women's Champion, and Charlotte Flair was the current Raw Women's Champion. So at the draft, Charlotte got drafted to SmackDown, even though she's the Raw Women's Champion, and Becky got drafted to Raw, where she's the SmackDown Women's Champion. So in between, so the draft took effect the day after Crown Jewel, so the SmackDown after that show. So before that, Charlotte Flair had a match with Bianca Belair for the Raw Women's title. Bianca Belair got drafted over to Raw. So apparently Charlotte wanted to drop the title to Bianca, but WWE didn't agree with it, even though Bianca was going to be on that roster anyway. So Charlotte went over. I forgot how she went over. I don't know if it was a DQ win or whatever. Anyway, Charlotte kept the belt. Then at Crown Jewel, Becky was in a triple threat with, I think it was, I might be wrong, people correct me, but I think it was Sasha and Bianca. So people was like, oh, if Sasha wins, that takes a... takes the SmackDown title to SmackDown while Becky retained. So on the SmackDown show itself, they decided to just hand each other's belts. So I'm like, right, you're devaluing the titles straight away. They'd done something very similar about a year or two ago with the tag team titles, same right. situation.
Right.
So apparently something was meant to happen where Charlotte was meant to give the belt to Becky, and like Becky kind of didn't want to give the belt because she liked the SmackDown belt, but she ended up giving it to her. But instead, Charlotte dropped the SmackDown title on the floor for Becky to go and pick it up, and then Becky basically just threw her the title belt, the SmackDown's title belt. So people's like, was it a rip, a work? Was it shoot? Apparently, Charlotte got hit. He backstage, I know what you're going to say, don't believe everything you hear, but apparently she was escorted out of the arena, I don't know, and she's got heat.
Remember what I told you? How easy it would be to work people through this bullshit? I'm not, I don't know, maybe, you know, maybe it did happen, maybe it didn't happen, but if I was... Now that I'm older, I guess a little wiser, maybe not still brain dead, but just collect your check, dude. Just show up, smile, do as you're told, collect your check, and make sure you invest it wisely. That's it. Because they're going to do that. Administration is going to do what they want to do anyway. It's all a rib. It's all a rib. Remember, you heard of Rip Rogers, right?
Yeah.
So... We were in OVW, and he was the coach. And every day he'd be like, guys, it's all fucking rib. I'm 18. I'm thinking, what the fuck is he talking about? It's all a rib. Because I was brought up with my dad, right? And, you know, you got, this is what feeds us. You got to take this serious, right? Then one day I'm on Raw. Now, mind you, Ric Flair, when he throws a chop, what do the people do?
Woo!
Exactly. So the office said, no more chops. Nobody's allowed to throw chops. It was to the point to where when you went to gorilla position, there'd be a big sign. No chops with like 15 exclamation points, right? Yeah. I think they actually even started fining guys. Like, because every time you threw a chop, they go, woo, you're putting over a guy. And Flair, I don't think he was on hiatus at the time. It made sense. Until we get to San Antonio. Main event, Shawn Michaels versus Triple H. They had about 20 minutes. Do you know what they did for about 15 of those 20 minutes? They threw chops.
Yeah.
And what did the crowd do?
Woo.
Went woo. And the next week, we had these, I call them group therapy sessions, these production meetings with the crew, right? And we had to sit there and watch the match. And I had to watch 15 minutes of chops when we're being told for the last 3 months not to throw chops. And then Vince gets up. What a match. That's when I heard Rip Rogers' voice. It's all a fucking rip. Collect your check and shut up.
It's a joke. It's all a joke.
But yeah, but obviously, Ric Flair's not with the company no more, and Charlotte is engaged to Andrade, who's in AEW, and everyone's just like, yeah, she can't wait to get to AEW. That's just all speculation. So you don't know, but,
yeah, but that would make the story look even more believable, wouldn't it?
Well, that's what people's thinking. So, yeah. So, but I can't imagine why she would want to leave AEW. She's one of the main faces of the company, and I would imagine she's getting paid pretty well. And she was part of the first women's WrestleMania main event. So it's not like she's been mishandled. She's still the champion now. So yeah. It's not like she's mishandled or been booked poorly. If anything, people complain that she's always been booked as strong. So I don't know. I think it's just WrestleMania just to have, you know, wind people up like they always do. And a lot of people believe it.
They're just looking for hits, man. They just want clickbait, bro.
Well, all respect to them.
Yeah.
Cool. So a couple of bits of AEW news. So Tony Schiavone, commentator, recently said in an interview that he's hoping he believes that AEW is going to be having their own streaming service next year, similar to the WWE Network. And funny enough, that kind of coincides with Ring of Honor. So apparently the Ring of Honor tape library, which goes back to like 2002, 2003, and obviously the likes of CM Punk, Bryan Danielson, Styles, Seth Rollins, so many came through ROH, Samoa Joe. So apparently the tape library might be up for sale. Ooh. So you would imagine that's going to be pretty valuable stuff. Obviously, look how much money WWE's made off the ECW and WCW libraries and world class and such. So I would imagine there might be a bit of a bidding war if that is true, because WWE definitely be after it. And AEW, if they are planning on a streaming service, well, you've got like nearly 20 years worth of material you can stick straight on your network. So thoughts on that? And do you think it's too much too soon for AEW to start thinking of a streaming service straight away?
They've only been around 2 years. What the fuck are they going to put on it?
Well, that's it. That's why, if they are, because it's like now, they've been putting out tweets lately, like, you know, this day in AEW history, and it's like the Gun Club joined AEW. I'm like, really?
It's like they're coming out with video games. It's like, fuck, maybe that's one way to establish your brand, because, I mean, a lot of their fans are probably, you know, gamers and stuff. So maybe out of the loop on all that stuff. That's not my scene, right?
Yeah.
But, you know, I mean, if he's willing to invest 8 figures into a video game, maybe they're gonna get a return on it. I don't know. Maybe it's a great way to you know, brand yourself towards the 18 to 49 demographic. Is that what they try to reach?
Yeah, the ones, you know, the 18 to 49.
Well, I'm 37. I haven't played a video game since I was 12, but that's me, yeah. Right? So I don't know.
But so speaking of AEW and some ratings, so obviously the ratings have been on a bit of a slump on the Fridays. We mentioned they had the head-to-head to SmackDown, and SmackDown had the overall amount of more viewers, but that coveted 18 to 49-year-old demo. Apparently AEW won it, so they're just... But anyway, the following week, SmackDown was on Fox. AEW Rampage was on whatever channel it was. AEW had, I don't know, 550, something like that, 500. SmackDown had 2.1 million. So, you know, the natural order was restored. But the interesting thing was the night after, on the Saturday night. So apparently, one of the, someone correct me, it might have been a baseball game, basketball game, I don't know. I think it got cancelled or it got rescheduled. So Fox was basically missing 2 hours worth of television from their schedule. So they decided to do the rerun of SmackDown that night.
Okay.
So, and it actually went up against Saturday night AEW Dynamite, which that's their main show, Dynamite. Well, the SmackDown rerun actually beat Dynamite. Which was life.
Wow. Well, dude, it's on Fox, right? That's a huge.
It's on Fox. It's a bigger channel, but still, it's a rerun right. From the night before.
Well.
And then this past week. Dynamite returned to its normal slot on the Wednesday. Good show, but a lot of people's predicting fact it was going to get back over 1 million and such, and it didn't, I'm afraid. It was still under 1 million, and I think people need to realize AEW has got that ceiling. It's around that 1 million mark. So, and the fact that the AEW fans, and this is what I was thinking of myself today, they keep slating the WWE fans. I'm thinking the fans who's going to be most likely to watch AEW are WWE fans.
Right.
If you keep slating what they're watching all the time, they're not going to want to know you.
Right. You're right.
Yep. So it's some interesting matches. CM Punk faced Bobby Fish, which that was a decent match. Bryan Danielson has been in the world title eliminator, so he might be getting a world title shot soon. They're teasing a feud between Moxley and Punk's. So, yeah, a few interesting things. So, good show. I can't complain. Like, this week's shows was pretty good. One thing that did happen this past Wednesday, though, it was NXT Halloween Havoc. So, our boy Bron Breakker was in the main event for the NXT title. And he came up short. He actually got defeated by Tommaso Ciampa. So, every other title got changed. The women's title was changed. Women's tag titles, normal tag titles. But yeah, the heavyweight title wasn't. So do you think that's a wise decision, not sticking a belt on them straight away?
Well, is there a return stipulation? Have they built up a return match?
So NXT's main shows are called Takeovers.
Oh, okay.
And they normally coincide with one of the big four events, so like a Survivor Series or Royal Rumble, be like the night or the night before, night after the big pay-per-view. So obviously they've got three takeovers. They'll have a takeover coming up pretty soon because Survivor Series will be coming up soon. So, but apparently from sources I've spoke to myself even, there's still really, really big plans for Bron Breakker, and he's going to be the face of NXT going forward. And when I watched the match, you could, he was not getting boos, but people was cheering on the other guy more. So in hindsight, even though I did want Bron Breakker to win, I think in hindsight it was probably wiser for him not to win just yet, because if there's one thing that can turn the fans on, it's pushing someone too much,
right?
Especially this day and age. I mean, back in the day when Lesnar best on the scene, I loved him. So, but these days fans are very different. They're very fickle, and they think they're smart. So,
That's probably smart they do that. They want to recreate like a Roman Reigns type of push. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Yeah. Probably smart on their part.
Yep. And another thing, what came up, it was on their YouTube channel. So, do we put out a video of the top 10 scariest women wrestlers?
Oh.
So, do you want me to run down the top 10 for you?
Sure.
Cool. So, and this list, I do not, like, I agree with some of them, but, like, number one, no way. So, number 10, someone you won't know, Mei Ling. She was on NXT recently. Number 9, Ariel. You got any memories of Ariel?
Next.
That, ladies and gentlemen, means there's a story off camera. Number 8, Karma, Awesome Kong. So I can agree with that. That was a, even though it was a real short run, though, unfortunately. Yeah. Number 7, Victoria. You was part of the company when Victoria was and when she first burst on.
Yeah. She's a good wrestler.
Oh, yeah. Played that, and I know she was, like, in a little bit of a mini tag with Stevie Richards when it was feeding with Trish Stratus, and, great gimmick. Number 6, current wrestler, Shayna Baszler. I don't know how she's scary. Number 5, Nikki Cross. Number 4, Sensational Sherry. I thought she might have been a little bit higher.
Yeah. She had that, like, psychotic but sexy look, you know what I mean?
Oh, yeah. Yeah, we've gone back and reviewed WWE pay-per-views from the past, and my appreciation of the Sensational Show has grown so much compared to when I was 6 years old.
Right. Yeah.
Number three, China.
Okay.
So, intimidating. I don't know if I could say scary. Number two, who I thought would have been number one, Lena Fishon.
Right.
Hmm.
She was probably the craziest.
Oh, sure. Definitely.
Yeah.
And number one, Alexa Bliss.
She's the current, like, pushed on the roster, right?
Well, she basically stole the Fiend's character off right. Bray Wyatt.
She's like the one they're promoting now. So obviously they're going to put number one, the current woman, right?
Yeah.
They're not going to try to promote something that's in the past. They're going to try to, number one is the current. That makes sense. Yeah.
And speaking of Bray Wyatt, so WWE actually, well, not WWE themselves. So there's a wrestling website, which for everyone watching and listening, do not believe this website because they've been wrong on so many things and make up things. But the interesting thing was, apparently, what this website wrote, Ringside News, everyone knows they're bullshit, but so they say, exclusive, internal opinion, that Bray Wyatt deserved to be fired by WWE. So they're implying that someone in WWE from the inside says that Wyatt deserved to be fired. So Bray Wyatt afterwards actually responded to a tweet of, you know, that gif of The Rock rolling his eyes?
Oh, yeah.
And then underneath it, he says, now that we have Johnny and Bruce's opinion, I would like to share mine soon. # Cult of Wyndham.
Oh.
Mm.
So he's going to have a return somewhere? You should start his own gimmick called the Wyndham Family.
Well, you know what I always found weird? Like, because he had a legit brother in WWE, Bo Dallas. I think his name is, what's his name? So Bray Wyatt's Wyndham Rotunda. Bo Dallas, I forgot his name now. Anyway, it was actually his legit brother, and they never acknowledged it on WWE TV.
Right. No, because he was the Wyatt family, right? And then recreate the fucking Wyndham family, and you know what I mean? Like,
bring IRS on. It's the father.
Sure. Does he have a sister? Make her a fucking valet or some shit.
Make her, yeah, that's right, yeah.
Yeah.
Well, apparently, people in Hollywood's actually looking at him and interested in bringing him to Hollywood.
Oh, really?
Oh. And it's weird because I interviewed Vince Russo earlier this year.
Yeah.
And he actually said, if I was Bray Wyatt, and this was way before Bray Wyatt got released, he said, if I was booking Bray Wyatt, he would never have needed to be the Fiend. I would have just kept him as Bray Wyatt. They could have done so much. He said, and if I was him now, with the Fiend, he said, I would take that character to Hollywood and make something of it, make a movie out of it, like a horror movie. So people just got a lot of bad opinions of Vince Russo, but when he spoke to me, this was like back, well, this must have been like April or March, when I think about it. He was bang on the money.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. I'm telling you, that the whole Wyatt thing, in my opinion, was the hottest like gimmick that they've had in the last 10, 15 years. It's the only one that caught my interest.
It's a great gimmick. And yeah. Obviously, yeah, did like...
I don't know who came up with the entrance theme.
Mm-hmm.
Whatever the fuck it's called. But that was a really catchy theme, you know? And when they turned off the lights and then everybody had their cell phones, and that was really cool. I enjoyed that. That was good. All right, is it time?
It's time. So tell everyone which time it is.
Wrestlemania. Wrestlemania.
Awesome. So, scoured the internet for year Rene. So, we found some memes. So, to start things off, we've got some.
Where is old Ryback? Is he still around? See, I don't do the social media shit, so I don't follow anybody. I just, you know.
Well, Ryback should take your advice, not do it himself. so, recent, well, not recently. So this is a few months ago now. So Jim Cornette said it best. Jim Cornette said, Ryback is the ultimate warrior, but without the success.
Oh, wow. So, fucking Jimmy, eh?
Oh, Jimmy, you know what he's like. But Ryback put a tweet out, like, you know, like a Twitter poll.
Yeah.
He said, you know, where should I go next? And it said, WWE/NXT, AEW, Impact Wrestling, or retire. And about 70-80% of people voted retire.
Well, he just set himself up for that one.
Well, then he did a follow-up one a week or two later. Right. And he said, right, I've got rid of the trolls. This is a legit poll now. Where should I go? WWE, NXT, AEW, or Impact Wrestling? And I think 60% said retire.
Okay, what's next? My cat ready to be fed his breakfast. I don't have a cat, but my dog's like that.
Oh, yeah. No, well, my mates, my children.
My client Brock Lesnar conquered the streak. That's cute. I conquered. Oh, snap. That's right. He did beat Goldberg's streak, right?
Yeah. Scott Hall with a taser. Jackknife by Nash. 1, 2, 3. And that was the end of Goldberg's run, basically.
Fucking run. $400 replica. $4 deodorant. Right?
Yeah.
Dude, I was at that show, man. I was at that show yesterday, and I had two guys, and all I have is 8x10s, but two guys spent $100 a piece, just themselves, on my 8x10s.
Oh, well.
You know what I mean? So I got to come up with some more merch, like t-shirts and buttons and fucking mugs and all that other shit. I just don't like dragging them around, right?
Oh, yeah.
Soon here to fucking Cafe De Rene because people are asking it. All we need is 20 more subscribers.
That's right. But speaking of the pictures we just saw there, did you see the pictures of the Jericho Cruise?
No, I did not.
All right. Are you aware of Chris Jericho Cruise?
I heard about it. Yeah. Is it once a year or something?
Something like that. Yeah. To be fair, it looks fun.
Yeah.
But I can only imagine the BO on that cruise.
Right?
Yeah.
If you remember this, your childhood was awesome. Yeah. You know that on they had that match on Saturday night's main event, and it did 33 million viewers in the United States?
Yeah.
What does Raw get now? They struggled to get 1.5 million?
That's crazy, isn't it? You know?
Right?
They say TV's changed. I'm like, has it changed to the point where 32 million people ain't watching it?
Right.
It's crazy. But yeah, it's amazing. I actually, I think I mentioned to you, I was on another show, Bang Bang Podcast, shout out to them, and we reviewed the Wrestling Classic from 1985.
Right.
Wow, man, it is like going through a time machine when you're watching this stuff. It was great stuff. I watched Macho v Dynamite, and Hogan against Piper, which was a fun match. But yeah, it's, man, I don't get me wrong, I appreciate the time I've grown up in because I've experienced like the Attitude Era and Ruthless Aggression Era and all that. But I do miss, I do kind of regret not living through the Hulkman era. But at the same time, I did have all of them on tape.
Right. Okay, so this TikTok?
Wrestling TikTok. So we've been watching the fan reactions. This time got the commentary audio.
She's jerking him off.
Kingston also has a nice move here. That's a nice on the addition.
This isn't your traditional steel cage. You can get a finger caught in there.
You can get a finger caught in there. Right?
My label, there's a lot of fine things I am, but label is not one of them.
Oh, he's admitting the truth.
Hey, wait a minute. Did I just mean to say that? I don't think you did. I'm alive. Jolly Rancher, keep on sucking.
Bruised ribs, and well, with all due respect, he's also suffering from anal bleeding.
Oh. Okay. Next one. Randy Orton.
Randy Orton.
Oh, let's watch that again. Oh. Now, see, if someone would have did that to Randy, I'm just telling the truth. What happened when Ken Anderson gave him that back suplex? What happened?
He got his papers, didn't he?
Well, he started pounding Matt like a little bitch, and then he fucking ran to the office and got Ken Kennedy fired. I don't give a fuck. Right?
Yeah. So, Kennedy was awesome as well.
I like Kennedy. He was always nice to me. Okay.
Oh, yeah. Pandora's out. Wait a minute. Total sex to see.
Oh!
What happened?
Not try that one again.
Oh yeah, Pandora's out. Wait a minute, total sex to see.
Is that sexy Eddie?
Possibly.
Yeah. You know the dick flip.
Yeah.
Joey Ryan. You know who invented it?
Was it him?
Yeah.
Oh.
So there's another case of some asshole stealing some of. Even though I hate the dick flip, I think it's ridiculous. I'm so glad that it no longer exists in our business. But it just goes to show that how people steal something from you and make all this money, and I don't know. It's wrong. So, okay, what's this?
Well, you know Lance Archer?
Oh, I saw a GIF or something like this. What happened? Did he, he fell on his head, obviously, but.
Yeah, just click on it.
Is he okay?
Bryce Remsburg. Checking in, can Archer continue? We see it again. See Watson land on his head here. Whoa! And if Archer.
Oh, did he really hit? Okay, there, yeah.
Archer landed on his head.
Apparently, apparently they cut the match short. Apparently, carried on a little bit, then they. Cut it short, and they had Eddie Kingston go over, which I don't think was the original plan.
Okay. Well, see, that's the thing, man. Like, I've seen him hit that a bunch of times. No problem. Right? It just takes one time, dude. And he's lucky because he's a big dude. I met him in person. He's fucking big, man. All that weight, top of your head and neck.
Well, that's it. I forgot who said it. You might know it is, but someone said, you know, just because you can do it doesn't mean you have to.
Right? Mm. Especially at that size, man.
Hi, big guy.
Okay, what's this one here?
World's greatest promo. Jeff Farmer.
Folks, there's jumping Jeff Farmer. Jeff, a while back, what a match you had with Motley.
Yep. Probably the hardest match I ever had in my life.
Yep.
But I don't like it when things aren't going my way. Motley Cruz, you turned the tables on me. You turned the tables in a wrong way. You got me mad now. I've stood around, I've listened to everything you had to say. I did everything necessary. But when you turn around and you backstab me one way or another, and you cheat me out of what's rightfully mine, that's when I get angry. Now I'm the one doing the challenging. I'm issuing a challenge to you, Motley Cruz. Get in the ring with me. This time, I'm going full force.
Looks like he's about to cry or laugh. I don't know. Oh, Marafuji. Oh, I saw this. How cool is this, eh?
Yep.
WrestleUniverse.com, everybody. Is this for the January 1st show?
I think so, yep. Got the Squid Game music in the background. Have you watched Squid Game yet, Renee?
Yeah, that's the big show. Hopefully, I pray to God I can be on it, man. Oh, and is that it?
That's it. Have you watched Squid Game yet?
Was that?
No,
I heard about it. What is this? Like a Korean show, right?
Yeah, I actually watched it before it became popular. So to sum it up, right, it's a Korean show. A lot of people's down on the look, like we all are. And he gets, one way or another, he ends up joining this game called the Squid Game.
Okay.
And it's basically, you know, about, you know, billions of you can win. But unfortunately, if you lose, you die. And it's it's like 456 people. And like when it gets down to the final person, he wins all the money. But the characters are so great in it. So I recommend it. It's on Netflix. So please definitely watch it.
Okay. Maybe we should start reviewing other stuff other than wrestling. Maybe we should start reviewing sport games. Right? Expand our audience a little bit.
Good. Well, Renee, thanks again. Another great show. And yeah, everyone, thanks so much for your support lately. Subscribers are going up. Last week's episode done really well. And yeah, it's, we really appreciate everyone. We've noticed that the amount of you who subscribe who actually returns to the episodes is sky high. So I want to say thank you to every single one of you who keeps returning, watching these videos, commenting and liking. It really does mean a lot. And Renee, tell them where they can find you.
You can find me trick-or-treating tonight because we're taping this on Halloween. I want to watch some scary movies and eat some candy. But Real Rene Dupree on Twitter, Cafe De Rene YouTube, please subscribe. And Cafe De Rene on Twitter as well, along with the Facebook groups. We're almost to 250, so we're almost ready to throw out some merchandise there for you. So I'd like to thank everybody. Bonsoir. À la prochaine.